Welcome on into the Daily Grossi. I'm your host, Nick Paulus. Joining alongside me, as always, Tony Grossi, the general of the Hundred Years' War. Tony, you wrote yesterday on the offensive changes that have happened for the Browns, adding Ken Dorsey, you know, going through new tight ends coach, Deuce Staley as a running backs coach. We have a ton of offensive overturn and what that all means. Can you just tell us a little bit about it? They were 10th last year in total points and offense, but they need to make those changes. Why do you think that all need to happen?
I think there's a couple of reasons specific to each coach. In the case of Ken Dorsey replacing Alex Van Pelt, this is an effort to get the best out of Deshaun Watson going forward, to tailorize an offense to maximize his talents. Dorsey has, you know, experience with dual threat quarterbacks like Cam Newton and Josh Allen. And Alex Van Pelt really didn't have much experience with this modern quarterback that the Browns suddenly have. And I think it came from on top that we need to do everything we can to maximize Watson. First step is getting him on the field and keeping him there. And I don't know how Ken Dorsey's going to improve that. But, okay, that's why they made the change at offensive coordinator. Okay, we know they had to make a change at offensive line because Bill Callahan was allowed to join his son, Brian, new head coach at Tennessee Titans. The other issue, though, with the other is running back coach Deuce Staley comes in. Stump Mitchell is out. Tight ends coach Tommy Rees is in, and T.J. McCartney is out. I think these were feelings that that they didn't want Kevin Stefanski to be stagnant. He had the same offensive staff for four full years, except for one change, and that was when Drew Petzing, the quarterback coach, joined Jonathan Gannon as coordinator of the Cardinals. So they want Stefanski to keep updating. You know, Andrew Berry in his season-ending press conference talked about how Andy Reid has changed over the years, and it's made him vibrant in his old age. And despite all his years coaching, he still changes. And that's what they want to see Stefanski do. And I think that this was an effort to get new ideas into the offense, but also to you've always done things. So as a result, you have four new offensive coaches, or five new offensive coaches, counting an assistant offensive line coach, who actually was a pretty good grab from the Philadelphia Eagles, a lateral move for the guy who was the assistant to Jeff Stotland over in Philadelphia. He's also an excellent offensive line coach. So they were able to get a pretty good assistant offensive line coach too. And then one change on defense, Nick, and that was Jacques Césaire, who came from the Houston Texans defensive line. Ben Bloom is out. He joined Tennessee. And Jacques Césaire worked under Matt Burke in Houston. Matt Burke is one of Jim Schwartz's proteges. So same kind of defensive philosophy up front. So you see, there were five major changes, six total on his staff, and there were a couple of reasons for all of them.
Well, with all the changes, do you view this as a good marker, or do you have some concerns?
No, my only concern is can Andy Dickerson and his new assistant make up for the loss of Bill Callahan, which I think is a big loss, it's unavoidable. But we'll see how that goes. I just think Callahan was so valuable that it's going to be difficult to replace him. But they got the guys they wanted, and we'll see how it goes. No one's irreplaceable. We know that. And I'm sure they'll do fine, but it's a little bit of concern in my mind.
Gotcha. All right, Tony, after the offensive staff here for us, let's talk about the Peter King Monday morning quarterback that he had wrote earlier this morning, basically letting everyone know his thoughts on the Browns-Eagles to Brazil game. He thinks that it is going to happen. I think that we've talked about this, a couple of times here in the past, Tone, but your thoughts on Peter now thinking that this is, you know, as close to a sure thing as possible.
I'm pretty sure, Nick, we were the first to associate the Browns with this Brazil game. And now it's approaching the point where it could be announced any time. The Browns are on the Eagles' home schedule. And the league doesn't like taking intra-division games in the international series. So let's go through Philadelphia's opponents. Dallas, Giants, and Washington probably won't be selected to go to Brazil with the Eagles. Okay, then the non-division opponents. One is Carolina. They are hosting a game in Germany this year. They're out. Atlanta is another. They just played in London like 2 years ago. They're out. Jacksonville is another one of their opponents. They're hosting possibly two of their own games overseas. So they'd be out as a road team, as a visitor. Then you have Green Bay. The league doesn't, the league wouldn't take Green Bay away from Philadelphia's home schedule. They're such a draw. They would leave that game alone. So then we come down to Cleveland or Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh hasn't played in an international game since 2013. The Browns last played, I think it was 2016 or 17, one of those 2 years. So you would think, well, Pittsburgh's turn is up. They could be the opponent. Well, it turns out that the Pittsburgh Steelers already have volunteered to host one of their home games in Mexico City next year. And the league likes when teams volunteer one of their home games. So they're not likely to be sent to Brazil this year. That leaves the Browns. And I think that is going to happen unless the league would loosen their, you know, restriction on sending Washington or the Giants there. But I doubt that will happen. So it looks like it could be Cleveland versus Philadelphia. Second day, Friday night, first week of the season. We'll probably know for sure anytime from now until the owners' meeting in late March. We'll know whether that game is scheduled for Brazil long before the rest of the schedule is released in May.
And Tone, just your final thoughts on that game itself. Are you a fan of possibly going to Brazil week one, you know, just to get it out of the way? Or like, where are you at with this?
Well, the good thing, it's a little easier because there'll be a 17-day lead-in from the last preseason game to the first regular season game. There always is that long layoff or 12 days, 10 days, whatever it is. But the regulars don't play in that last preseason game, so it turns out to be almost 17 days. So the Browns have, or any team going over there would have ample time to prepare, to leave early. However, it wouldn't be as much of an inconvenience as later in the season. Now, the other side of that is we know that the Browns Stadium is hosting that Billy Joel Rod Stewart concert the following week. I think it's a Friday night game, a Friday night concert. So more than likely, if the Browns are sent to Brazil in week one, they will also be on the road in week two. Somewhere, maybe somewhere close, like Pittsburgh or Cincinnati. So it is what it is. We'll find out if that's the way it turns out. But, you know, the Browns to Brazil seems to me the most likely event of that series.
All right, Tony, and to wrap it up here for us on the Daily Grossi, this is actually an article from Jeremy Fowler on ESPN Plus. This was from a couple of days ago, and he talks about the NFL overhaul tiers for all 32 teams and where they're at from contenders to rebuilds. It starts off with still major contenders in that grouping. He has the Baltimore Ravens, the Detroit Lions, Kansas City, San Francisco. The next tier down, he has needs a postseason breakthrough. He has the Buffalo Bills, the Cowboys, the Miami Dolphins, and then in a category which is a little slightly lesser of that, teetering contenders, he has the Cincinnati Bengals, the Philadelphia Eagles, as the only two in that one. Right below that, headed on the right track. He has the Cleveland Browns, the Green Bay Packers, the Houston Texans, Jacksonville Jaguars, Los Angeles Rams, and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. You know, Baker Mayfield and the Bucs, most likely, if Baker re-signs there. He says that injecting some confidence into Deshaun Watson after a rocky 2 years, Cleveland is the number one, is their number one job this offseason. It's a pivotal year for him, blah, blah, blah. We know that whole story way too well. Tony, do you agree that they are headed on the right track, or do you believe that they should be in the teetering contenders or, you know, still major contenders category just ahead of them?
Yeah, I think I'd rate them higher than Jeremy did. Whatever tier is just above that. Because
that is the teetering contenders. That's with the Bengals and the Eagles.
Yeah, you look, I mean, let's... You know, not everything is based solely on the quarterback. You look at the lines of scrimmage, the Browns' offensive line and defensive line are both in great shape, and they're going to be upgraded, I think, the defensive line, in fact. So when you measure just those two portions of the team, I think they deserve to be ranked higher. And if they could win games with four different quarterbacks with, you know, I think that's one of the reasons why their lines of scrimmage are so strong on defense and offense. So we often, you know, look just at the quarterbacks when we rank these teams. And sometimes you got to go, well, you should go well beyond that. And I think the Browns, minus the uncertainty about Deshaun Watson, if you take that position away, they're as strong as anyone, the rest of the team, particularly on offensive line and defensive line. So, yeah, I'd move them up higher, at least one tier higher.
Yeah, and he goes on to say, you know, that the offensive line depth and the is relatively good. He does have question marks about Nick Chubb as well as Amari Cooper, both of those which are the major concerns here for the Browns as well. You know, that going into this offseason, those are two of the, you know, better players on this roster. What are you going to do with them? That's kind of where he sort of interjects everything at. So I'm in agreement with you, Tone. I think that they should be a little bit higher above that. Maybe we're just wearing brown and orange shaded glasses. But, you know, that's, I think that's, we can both agree they should be a little bit higher on this one.
Absolutely. And again, look at the rest of the team, and I think they're in much better shape than some of the teams he's got ranked above them.
Yeah, no doubt about that. No doubt about that. All right, Tone. Well, that is going to wrap it up here for the Daily Grossi. You will be back tomorrow, most likely with Chris Oldak. Maybe it's me. Who knows? We'll find out. But this has been the Daily Grossi on the Land on Demand. Thank you for listening on here. If you're watching on YouTube, thank you for that as well. You can catch all of Tony's stuff on the Land on Demand. All of his writings, Daily Grossi, 100 Years Pod, everything's on there. It's all fantastic. Thank you guys so much, and have a wonderful day.